Praise the Lord. Dylan, I'm proud of you. And the Dixons, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of this church. You know, in the very beginning, this is kind of a ragtag church. We were known as the church full of misfits. And you're it. But you know what? We were all misfits. Every one of us. And I'm proud to be a misfit for Jesus. I was broken and I was down and I was crushed and I was, but you know what? There's nothing better than coming out of a disaster and knowing where you came from. The Lord saved me. And I want to talk just a little bit today about where we're all going. It's called heaven. So bow your heads with me. Lord, this is the word of God. I pray that you'll take the word and it will be established in our hearts. Don't let it change. Bless us with it today, Lord. Help us to change our view in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want you to turn to Revelation 21, if you would. In my Bible, Revelation 21, I always know where to go in my Bible for Revelation 21. I have a picture. And that picture is a picture of me and my dad. And I'm laying my hand on my dad on his last breath. I got to reading the word over him, and every one of us went around the room, and there were 21 people there. We went around the room, and everybody gave him a kiss, and I knew that we had to say goodbye to my dad because he was strong. He loved his family. My dad didn't want to go anywhere unless he knew we were safe. We all went around the room and I said, you know, I really believe that this should happen. And all the way down to little Maggie. Maggie was the youngest one, little baby. And they held her over and she kissed grandpa, great grandpa, on the face. And my dad, for the very first time, he hadn't moved in a while, picked up his head, smiled, laid it on the pillow, and I reached over and I put my hand on his chest. He took his last breath. Life is not what we're doing right here. This is not life, what we're doing. It's not life where America is going. It's not life where our families are going. This is not life. Life is our families pouring into Jesus, telling people about Jesus. My dad, you know, he wasn't perfect. He did a lot of things wrong in his life, but the thing that he did right in his life was he loved his family. He would have done anything. I keep him on Revelation 21 because my life needs to be about something that is not here. It's gone. It's there. His name is Jesus. We get tied up. We listen to other things. We get involved, and I don't care if it's politics over here, and everybody knows I hate politics because of what it is. I don't hate politics because it's politics. I hate politics today because of what it is. Politics is crooked. It's almost evil. Everybody's attacking everybody. Over here we have the church, and the church doesn't know whether or not to close, whether or not to open, whether or not to wear a mask, whether or not to take off a mask. Why? The church has a problem listening to God, even knowing what God wants. And I take a look at it, and you need to understand that you're my family now. You're my family. Welcome to the family. And I have a responsibility now to be able to do what my father did to me. And that is to somehow apply the biblical principles into your life by acting them out. I pray that I will always be a good example to you. I never want to be a bad example. Revelation 21 is about the perfect state of all of this being made perfect. And I'm going to walk you through this, and I want everybody to pay attention on how we're going to do this. Comes off of scripture that we're right in the middle of something happening that's really big. And all of these things are about ready to absolutely crush the earth, because this angel is full of these vials and he's ready to release these vials. He stops for a minute. He stops in the middle of everything. And look what he does. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea, which sea is just a word right here. It's halls, and it's the word halls just means salt. And I don't know if in the very beginning, maybe there wasn't any salt in the sea. Maybe everything was fresh, because salt kills, you know. So we don't know what that is, but he says that there was no more sea. And then, and I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Now, when we talk about this holy city, this New Jerusalem, we're talking about a church that became the bride, that was madly in love with Jesus. Not anybody else. If you put your wife, your children, anything in front of Jesus, it says you're not worthy. And this, I want to show you a picture of this. And let me say this also, that this is probably the only chapter that you're really going to read. You're going to get some other little influences in Scripture on this. But this is the only chapter that really deals about what heaven looks like. And it is so glorious. And yet, you could take this chapter and you could apply it to your thoughts, and it won't even come close to what it is. Heaven goes beyond what you can fathom, beyond what you can think. And I can think of some pretty cool stuff, but you know what? I'm not into gold, and I'm not into silver. I like flowers. I'm a guy, I know, it sounds a little weird. I like flowers. I like gardens, like ponds. I like fish. I like art. I like to be surrounded by art, because art is picturesque. It's beautiful to me. I like beauty. And you know what makes beauty? God. God. Everything that you cherish on earth, the highest quality, diamonds, rubies, emeralds, gold, transparent gold, monatomic gold. For some others that are in here, that type of stuff, that's the highest thing that man is searching for right now, because it's absolutely everywhere. And at the same time, that's pavement in heaven. That's pavement. Can you imagine walking down the road? Poof! Oh man, it really hurt. I hit a 5-pound chunk of gold. You see? It lets us know that everything that man craves down here is just the beginning of what is there. just the beginning. This holy city that he talks about is made, there's reference to this back in Revelation chapter 3. And in Revelation chapter 3, there's this church. And it makes, again, a difference between this church and the next one. The first church is the sixth church. It's in Scripture, but it's Philadelphia. Philadelphia just means brotherly love. It's a real easy term, and it just means I love God and I love you. And it's real. And that's Philadelphia. We have in America, Philadelphia, brotherly love. It's interesting because, well, I won't get into the history of that. You'll have to stay down on your own. Otherwise, it's just another subject. So Philadelphia Church was given a name that was not given to any other church. The New Jerusalem. And at the end of Revelation chapter 3, the two churches that it speaks about, it's talking about a church that overcomes, and you're going to talk, and we're going to talk about that because he's going to finish that topic that he was on in Revelation 21. He talks to that church of Philadelphia, and he says, to them that overcome, this is what I'm going to do for your life. I'm going to make a pillar. I'm going to make you a pillar in the temple of my God. Well, there's four pillars. Rabbinical writings that already tell you that, you know, you have the triune power of God, the Godhead. Well, what's the fourth? There's four of them that are on the outside of the Holy of Holies. It's one that marries into it, and that's the bride of Christ. And so here we are, we're talking about, he said, I'm going to make you a pillar in the temple of my God, and you shall no more go out. I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down from God. So you've been given a name as the bride of Christ. You've been given a name, okay? The New Jerusalem. Now, we have to remember that. We should not forget that, because now he's coming back to that. The next church after that is Laodicea, or Laodicea if you're in Turkey. But Laodicea. Laodicea means rule of people, or rule of the people. It means that the Holy Spirit stopped ruling that church, and now people rule that church. So on the last day after Philadelphia, you have a church that is ran by the people. It's a business. It's an organization. It's a big business structure that is out there. And that's what we see so much around this world today. I don't care about the business part of it. I don't care about the money part of it. Everybody knows, oh, it takes money, it takes money. You know what? We did church long before we had a building. We did church before we had money. We did church, why? Because you are the church. You can do church without all of this. We are the church of a living God. Amen? And I'm glad you came to see us again. So as we read through this, here comes this holy city adorned as a bride adorned for her husband. That means she's beautiful. She is absolutely beautiful. Do you know the church is supposed to be beautiful? And even right here on the earth, it's so beautiful that people are actually attracted, and your kindness that God gives you is what leads others to repentance. It's God's kindness, but he gave it to you. I really believe if I love the guy that shot me so much, I believe that that love will bring him to repentance. You watch. We will be one day right in front of this pulpit right here, and he will be right at my right side, and we're going to be given our testimony of what God has done in our lives. Praise the Lord. It says, and I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. So now this tabernacle that used to be in the wilderness, and then this temple that used to be in Jerusalem, is where everybody used to go into the Holy of Holies, which is very important. Because he's saying that tabernacle, I don't know if it was all the rest of it, but the tabernacle itself just happens to be four square and gold. Where the Holy of Holies sat. And when they went into the Holy of Holies, they had to be so careful because they had to be cleansed. And if the priest had all this garbage in his life, he couldn't go out there and represent you to God, or God to you also. But he just couldn't make it. Or he would die in the presence of a holy God. And so he's given this representation of the Holy of Holy, the place where God, where his Shekinah glory actually resides, this new Jerusalem that is four square. He's saying, this is like the Holy of Holies. The representation is there, and it says, just like he was in your life, this is the Holy of Holies right here. This is where God's Shekinah glory resides in our lives. That's why you're a light that is set up on a hill to be seen of men. And when people see it, they go, man, I love that. Man, I love that. Thank you. Thank you for being a good representation. Thank you for saving my life. Thank you for being there when I needed you. I even hated you at the time, and you still loved me. I never answered your phone call. I never answered your text. I never did. I said that because it happened so much. But I want to thank you for loving me. And I hope that there's lots of you up there one day, and I know that that's what you'll say. Thank you for answering my text when I was so rude, crude, indecent, nasty, hateful, and rotten. God's authority is all over. His Shekinah glory enforces that authority. So his authority is in my life by grace and by mercy and by love and by affection. I want to be obedient to him. He says that God himself shall be with them and be their God. Now we're going to get this. The conditions that things are going to be in. And God said he's going to wipe all the tears from their eyes. I wonder when he said that. I mean, he's talking about heaven and a new earth. And he says he's going to wipe all the tears from there. What about happy tears? What about happy tears? I was going to look up tears. And as I was going through, it's like, you can't tell. I mean, when he says he's going to wipe away all tears, does that just mean the bad tears? What about the good tears? Do you know what I'm going to feel if I get there and I'm looking all over the place and I'm seeing all of these millions of people? I hope it'll probably be less than we think, but I'm going to be looking all over the place and boom, there's Todd. And I see Todd at the other end over there. Do you know? I'm going to cry. What about when you're running towards the pearly gates? Grandma, grandpa, mom, dad, and they're all standing at the gates. Say, come on, Tim, you don't think I'm going to cry? Now, I don't know what tears mean, but I can tell you that tears are going to flow like crazy. But they're not tears of sadness. They're tears of so much joy coming out of me because the souls were saved, because I made it home. This is not my home. I thought I was going home. And the Lord decided I was staying. See what you girls did? Heaven, you guys, is not about, you're going to find out here, it's not about the place. It's about the person. Because when I see my dad there and my grandparents, when I see my mom there, who's not dead yet, no hurry. But when I see them there, do you even get the amount of mercy and the amount of grace that I'm going to feel at that time that God has had? It is absolutely unreal how good God has been. He saved my family. I'll see my boys over here. I'll see my daughter start running up and saying, Dad! And boom, crying again. So when it says it's going to wipe away all tears, please, don't read that it's going to wipe away your emotion. God has so much emotion. Jesus himself cried over Jerusalem. Oh, you bet I'll cry. I'll be, man, when I see my kids there, then I'll be able to say, I've done what I've been called to do. Thank you, Lord. Then, what we talked about, Dixons. You done a good job when your kids come in. It's important to be everything that we can be for everybody. Paul says, I'm all things to all men, whatever it takes to be Christ to them. I am that. See, Paul, how can you say that? That is God's mercy on people. That is God's grace on my life, that we need to be heaven for somebody else. Heaven is not about the gold and the silver. Heaven is about the person of Jesus. God shall wipe away their tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. So he relates tears to death, and with the sin that was behind us, said, now, all of those things that would make you cry, like leaving somebody behind, for some, I don't know how he's going to do it, but it says those former things are passed away. They're gone. So evidently, we won't even know. You won't have any reason to be able to bawl your eyes out because maybe I didn't do something right. See, in my life, I'm constantly... Danny and I have one thing in common, Pastor Danny and I, and we always... You can't tell us anything that we don't already pick on ourselves for. You could say, man, Tim, you're ugly. Okay, I know that. Try something else. Well, Pastor Tim, you're that. Yeah, I already know. You see, I'm hard on myself when I do something stupid. Pretty hard. Danny's the same way. He's hard on himself. So we already know these things. But the former things and the things that I'm going to get to heaven, I'm going to worry about so much, the Lord's just going to pass right over. And I would want to remind him, well, Lord, what about what? You see, those former things are gone. And he that sat upon the throne said, I want to talk about this voice. After I was shot, this was the fourth day in, I was still in somewhat of I was out of it. And I had all this darkness around me, and I told everybody it was just absolutely evil. And these entities would come out of darkness, and they had long spears and swords and knives, and there was perverseness, and there was... and I was trying to ask the Lord, what is all of this? If I'm dying and I'm leaving, why do I got to see all of this first? And in the end, I think he was revealing something to me. I don't even want to get into it because it would be embarrassing, but the condition of the church in the last days and the falling away that has taken place. And here I am in this darkness, and I got this cellophane. It's just blowing in the wind around me. It's like cellophane. As if that's going to protect me. But all of these things were going towards me, and then they would just veer away like this, like a shark coming at you, but then it just, boom, and it would just take a different direction really quick. Nothing could touch me. But I would wake up now and then, and my wife would be right there. She never left my side. And I did not want to go back into that state again. And I would just hope just to stay awake long enough to be able to look at Cindy, get eye contact, and just hang on. And Cindy was a lifeline to what was alive. And then that's when the Lord asked me questions. What do you want to do, Tim? What do you want to do? Now, I knew heaven was before me, and so it was obvious. And I said, Lord, I just want to go home. I want to go home. I can't live like this. If you were to tell me 5 years ago that I'd still be dealing with the pain that I'm dealing with today, that's why the Lord doesn't tell you that. Okay, it's a bummer. We'd go, 5 years? No. But that's when he spoke to me and I said, well, Lord, I just want to go home. And then I don't even know why I thought it. I don't know why I had the reaction that I had. But then it hit me that 35 years prior to that, I had made a covenant with God that he owned my life. And now I'm wanting to make the decisions. And I just started to cry, and I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to make those decisions. I said, Lord, I gave you my life for you to make those decisions. I said, if you want me to go, I will go. If you want me to stay, then I will stay. To die is gain, but to live is Christ. And if you want me to suffer, I'm going to have to do it with a smile on my face, and I'm going to have to do it with grace. And so I need you to give me joy in the middle of tribulation, if this is what you want me to do. Because I knew that if I lived, I obviously was going to go through stuff. I didn't even know what I looked like. Okay, I'm sitting there in the hospital, nobody is saying really anything. And I thought my face was all disfigured, because when you get hit in the head with a bullet, you think this side's gone. Okay, because I got hit on that side of the parking lot, and I thought my head was on this side of the parking lot, but it was still connected. But it literally shoved the inside of my brains up against the wall. That's why I forget things and stuff now. And I thought, Lord, if I want to go to heaven. But then it hit me, that is not my decision. My life does not belong to me. Somebody paid the price for my life. And I tried. But I think the Lord was just trying to ask me, what is it that you want, Tim? And I had to give it back to him. My want doesn't come into play. It is not my will. It's thy will be done. And at that time, that little tiny little thing that protected me, okay, that looked like anybody could just rip it to shreds, for some odd reason it got taut. It's like somebody put air in it, and I don't know why, just blew it up, and it went tight. And then I heard a voice. And that voice, I don't know how many of you have been at a concert to where somebody hits the lowest note on the synthesizer, and it absolutely shakes the place. Anybody ever been in one like that? But that noise that came out was a voice. And that voice said, that's enough. And after 4 days of being in torment, of Satan trying to take my life for 4 days, it was over. And all of the darkness started breaking up. And I opened my eyes. And of course, there's Cindy. I never went back into that state again. There is Cindy. All the instruments came up. That was the day that everybody knew Tim's going to be okay. Now, I still look like this, but I'm okay. Some of you are going, where's the other side of your face? I was born like this. Now listen to this. When he said, I'm going to make all things new, that's the way that I picture it. I made all things new. Boom. When he says things, he plants stars in the heavens just by a whew. So when he says, I make all things new, everything that you thought from before is in the past. And everything before you now is far up and beyond what you can imagine. Nothing is the same. Nothing is even how you could ever imagine it. You could think all you want on how beautiful it would be. I could think of the most beautiful gardens in the world. And the Lord's up there going, you ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't seen nothing yet. It's like, well, Lord, man, if I could just live here, you ain't seen nothing yet. You see, unless you go through the trials, you're not going to be tested by your faith. And if you don't have faith, you won't make it. So we go through stuff here, and the trials here, it's the Lord asking you, how are you going to respond today? How are you going to respond to that? How are you going to respond to that? My response needs to be Christ. You say, well, we're all human. Stop justifying your flesh. You call yourself human. I got shot for being an alien. There you go. Human? The Bible literally says that when you're born again, you're not of this world. It says you're standing before Him at Mount Zion. Mount Zion is not here. But do we get it? And He said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. In other words, they're going to come out and you can count on it. And He said unto me, it is done. Second time. One, at the cross, it is finished. Two, when we actually see the groom, and He shows us the end, and He says, it is finished. Everything else is in the past. Now, everything is brand new. New heaven, new earth, new everything, new you. You even have a new name. We used to sing the song to remind us, there's a new name written down in glory. Oh, it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. Okay? That was a song we used to sing. Now we don't know that we get a new name because we don't sing it. You're going to have a new name. How many here hate your name? You get a new one. Okay? From now on, Tyler, they're going to call you George. Okay? Hey, the Lord picks it. Don't whine. So, He's going to identify Himself right here. He said, it's done. I am. I love that. The Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. And then He's going to finish up on Revelation 2 and 3 on the seven churches. He's going to finish it. He that overcometh. Well, He just got through giving the teaching in Revelation 2 and 3. To him that overcome, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. To him that overcome, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which sits in the midst of the paradise of God. To him that overcome, will be sitting with me on my throne. And He says, to him that overcome, shall inherit all things. I will be his God, and he shall be my son. So in the seven churches, if you overcame all those things in the seven churches, whatever relates to you and whatever problem you have, if you overcome whatever problem, whatever temptation, whatever slaps you across the head, if you overcome it, you will be there as the Son of God. That's cool. Now listen to this. Now He's going to go to the other side. If you overcome, I'll give you this. But then He comes over here and He says, okay, but to this group of people, those are, by the way, the ones that did not overcome. Count them. There's the fearful. There's the unbelieving. There's the abominable. There's the murderers. There's the whoremongers. There's the sorcerers. There's the idolater. And there's all the liars. Shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. The fearful? Oh yeah, He gives a parable on that one. There was a servant that was there, and he was only given one talent. The rest of them were given more talents than him. They doubled him. But one man was given only one talent. When he was given that talent, he didn't do anything with it. In fact, he buried it. And then when they asked him, what in the world did you do? How come you didn't do anything? He said, man, I was fearful. I was scared. I knew that you were a God that we needed to be afraid of. And so what I did is I buried it because I didn't want to lose it. That was an unfaithful servant. I gave it to you to multiply, and you didn't do anything to it. Listen, church, He's given you a chance. Are you the type of servant? He was still a servant. Are you the type of servant where the Lord gives you the power of the Holy Spirit in your life upon salvation? What are you doing with it if you do nothing? It says, is that servant which cast into outer darkness with there is weeping and gnashing of teeth? Well, why, Lord? I was your servant. You're a worthless servant. Well, that's harsh. Yeah. They're all around us. They're servants that absolutely have no fruit in their life whatsoever. The best fruit that you can ever go into heaven with is another soul. Amen. Yeah. Another soul. And if I have to, I'll drag them along with me. Right, Caden? If I have to. I got you, bro. You're a good kid. You really are. And as we go through this, you need to understand is that these group of people are the eight groups of people, and they're on the opposite side of the ones that overcame. The Lord told them how to overcome. He did in the seven churches. He did in the seven epistles that were actually written to them, the rest of the churches, but he actually did to them here. And you can overcome this. To the church of Ephesus, he wrote the book of Ephesians. And Ephesians is one of the seven books where he actually addresses them and he says, hey, this is how you don't lose your first love. That's what Ephesians is all about. Identifying yourself in Christ and knowing that you got a purpose and you have an identity in Christ. And each one of those churches were told how to overcome, how not to go to hell. And what do they still choose? Hell. It's just what we do. We're not the smartest creatures he created. Think about it. Look at us. We should scare you. And there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials full of the last seven plagues. Who is it? Here it is. Wow. Now that would scare me enough. Like, why are you coming to me? You're the one that's got all the vials of the seven plagues. You're kind of looking at me. He came to him. And he talked. And he said, come hither. I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. Now here we go. This is where doctrine takes a real firm grasp. Because now he's going to identify who this bride is. It's the New Jerusalem. Going back to Philadelphia, going back to loving God with all your heart and loving your neighbor as yourself, you have fulfilled the law. Enter now, thou good and faithful servant. People, when you love your enemy, you know you're getting somewhere. When you pray for those that persecute you, now you know that you're getting somewhere. Most people, you haven't been tested into those things yet. We think, oh man, we're getting far. We haven't even entered into some Christianity in America. Wait till you hit China. Wait till you hit that pastor in Canada right now that's incarcerated. They put him in jail and they had to put a fence around his church. It's huge. And they said, you will not worship in that church anymore. Welcome to Canada now. People are starting to lock down. Then where is your faith? You get mad? Oh, I can hang around a Christian until that Christian gets mad. Then once they get mad, oh, then they come up with every excuse. Why they use foul language. Why they hate people. Why they complain and whine and bellyache and do all this. It's like, stop it. I want you to go home and listen to some counsel. Bob Newhart, and it's called Stop It. Just look it up. Okay? You guys, don't look it up. You're not supposed to have your phones. But if you look it up, all it is Bob Newhart standing there going, well, just stop it. Well, you don't understand. No, we don't go there. Well, you don't know. We don't go there either. Just stop it. Why is it that we can't? Why is it? So he's going to show them the bride. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain. And he showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. That is what He promised to the Philadelphia church. And remember, he's coming back, not just for the church, but for a glorious church. Not because you go to church, but a glorious church without spot or wrinkle that's been washed in the blood of the Lamb. The outward appearance, having the glory of God. Yes, a glorious church. It specifically says here, having the glory of God. Her light was unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystals. I haven't even got into 13 pages of notes. I'm still in the scripture. Sometimes I hate myself for that. It's like, that's good material. And they never heard it. Except this is the word, so it's better. Now it's going to give the walls, the gates, the foundations, and it had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates were 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. You're going to be looking around this thing, and you're going to find, we're practicing this now with some of the new guys that are coming up in ministry. But Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Zebulun, Issachar, Asher, Dan, Gad, Naphtali, Joseph, and Benjamin, all the tribes are going to be there. And they're representing that when God calls somebody, he qualifies him, and he's good enough to get them there all the way. Amen. And they're going to go, well, yeah, Israel, they've been nothing but rebellious all these years. Watch what God does. Because you're talking about Israel being rebellious? Have you met America? Look at us. Having God's grace and God's mercy and God's prosperity all over us. And look what we have done. We're burning our cities down. We hate our officers and those that are in leadership whatsoever. We hate anything that's godly. We kill our children and we have abortions right and left. And it means nothing. We pay for it by our tax dollars. We accept a bunch of money from government when we have not even worked for it whatsoever. Our government's nothing but a handout. And it's turning into nothing but communism. And what do we do in America? We keep the boat flowing somehow. We need to rebuke it in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Go ahead. See, the reason it is what it is because nobody's rebuked it. I often wondered what would happen. To get a born-again believer in Congress that actually stands up and he heard from God. And we have a modern-day Elijah in Congress that says, thus saith the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come, the beginning and the end, that which was dead and now is alive. If you don't do this, then I will do this. And I wonder what they would do in the face of God. Because most of them would defy him face to face. And I pray that God delivers America. But I pray that it's, when he does it, I pray that there is the hand of God on everything. And I pray that God's finger puts his finger down right in the center of it and says, stop it. Or, I pray that we'll hear from God first. That way they'll know. And Bible, the Bible's very particular. And they shall know that I am your God. Isn't that cool? How are they going to know? Somebody's going to call it out. On the east there's three gates, on the north there's three gates, on the south there's three gates, and on the west there's three gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the name of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. Well, why? Because that was the foundation of Christianity, is he chose 12 men, Peter, Andrew, James, John, Matthew, Philip, Bartholomew, Thomas, James, Thaddeus, Simon, and Judas. And Judas was wiped out, Matthias took his place. And so those things that are foundation to us, those things that we have learned, that is the foundation. Those are the people that held the doctrine and did not waver at all their walk with Jesus Christ. says, and he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city and the gates thereof and the wall thereof. And now they're going to measure it. The eternal city. This is the capital of the galaxy. This is the capital of everything, the New Jerusalem. And the city lieth four square. The length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed number 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height of it are equal. Same thing as the Holy of Holies. Okay? As just so you know. But here, you have about 1,384 approximate by the furlongs, feet, or miles. High, length, breadth. I don't know what happens in between. But here's a city that comes down. It never says it. It actually touches the actual earth. But it is a city. And he measured the wall thereof in 140 cubits according to the measure of a man, that is, of the angel. That's pretty big. The wall of it is pretty big. Okay? If you go with a 25-inch cubit, that would be a 300-foot wall. So in the building of the wall. So in this wall, we always think, oh, this is the wall that separates Mexico from Texas. No! Listen to the way that this wall was built, this actual wall. It says the building of the wall of it was jasper. And the city, pure gold. Except when it mentions pure gold, it's actually a transparent gold. You can see through it. Way cool. It's the same gold they actually use over the astronaut's windshield to protect him from the sun's rays. And it's actually what was in the original foundation, I believe, in the earth that encompassed the whole firmament of the earth, and it kept us from the protection of the sun. That's why Lamech, being 777 years old, when he died, when the deluge actually hit, when the flood actually hit, okay, there was only one man that lived out to that 300 years. That was Noah. And then past that, everybody went down to 100 some odd years. And then here we are. And now the Lord says, yeah, well, pray that you get to 70. And it says that it was pure gold like unto clear glass. You think gold is yellow. It said, and the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all the manner of precious stones. You're walking all over them. And you got to remember, the light that is in there is so intense. It says, there is no need of the sun. Better hurry. And all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper. The second was sapphire. It goes through and it mentions all of these. And then it starts on the gates after it goes to that. And the gates, it says that each gate, okay, the 12 gates where there was angels standing at each one of these gates, allows people in or out, whoever you were. It says they were fashioned of one pearl. That's cool. Can you imagine? Oh, what's this gate made of? Hey, dear, it's a pearl. A pearl? Yeah. How high is it? It's a high gate. That's one pearl. Girl. I had to throw that in there. I'm a poet.
And you didn't even know it.
And I didn't know it. I know. Anybody here find that, like, really cool? Yeah. Now, all of that is really cool. But we haven't even touched on the gardens. You say, what garden? Don't even mention gardens. Really? You see, there's a new heaven and a new earth. This part is only the New Jerusalem. He's going to make a garden. He's going to make the earth like he did at the very beginning. The only problem is now there's no sin. The animals, the flowers. Men, we won't have to till the soil anymore. No labor, just walk around. Would you enjoy God and would you enjoy your garden? Amen. Where the lion literally lies down with the wolf? Think about it. That's cool. A month ago, I killed the last lion in my yard. So after we get through with this, starting verse 21, the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, as if it were transparent glass. And that's gold. That is a certain type of gold. You have to talk to Jerry about some of that stuff if you want to learn about that. But, and I saw no temple therein. Okay, why? Why? Because he already told us where the temple was. Okay, hold on though. Here on earth, where's the temple? We are. Now, where are we now? We are now married. Okay, we're the bride of Christ. I don't know why, but we are now the bride of Christ. Okay, and it's going to get into that. I saw no temple thereof, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. While you're here, we represent Christ because he's in us. When we go there, everything that you are is laid at the feet of Jesus. He is the light that's in the middle of it. Now listen to this. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. Well, why? What do you do for light? Don't worry about it. There is no darkness at all. It says, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. Do you know you have no light yourself at all? Light is energy. Energy is light. You're supposed to give off a certain amount of light. Okay? We could talk about that for a week. But the bottom line is, it's all Christ. You're only alive because of Christ. The only light that you have is a light that is a little tiny little pilot light that was put inside of you when you're born. There's a light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world. And you have one. It's a little pilot light. Billy, search for it. Know that it's there and light it up. And then wait for the healing. Light it up. In the midst of your trauma, in the midst of your turmoil, light it up. And watch for healing. It's called faith. He put it in there in the very beginning, waiting for you to use it. That's why that's his Shekinah glory. You can't stand in his glory and not be healed. It says, now listen to this. Here's this bride. Now here's where it gets really tricky, and I'm going to try to close up here in just a second. So now here's this bride, and here we all, we're all, you know, we are lit up as the new Jerusalem, and God and the Lamb are the light thereof. And then in the next verse it says, and the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it. Okay, now hold on now. Who are the nations of them which are saved? If the bride is there, and then it's shining out, and God and the Lamb are the light thereof, and the bride is in there with them. Who are the nations of them which are saved? And then it says, and the kings of the earth do bring their glory into it. What kings? Who are the priests? Who are the servants? Who are the kings? Who are the guests? Who are the... There's seven different entities that are in heaven. Who are they? But there's only one bride. So everybody says, oh, I'm going for brideship, or I'm going to get in by the skin of my teeth. Let me tell you something. If you want to get in by the skin of your teeth, then praise the Lord. I hope you do. But you know what? I want to fall in love with Jesus. I want to be his bride. Amen. How come you guys didn't clap? Very good. Okay. Yeah. I should have a little sign. Clap. So, and the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day. Why? Because there's going to be no night there. Well, how am I going to sleep? You guys don't get it, do you? Did the Bible ever say that you get sleep? Tyler's back there going, oh no, the best part of my day is gone. How many here love sleep? The others that didn't raise their hand are asleep. Wake up! Everybody, we love sleep here. Why? Because we're tired. Why? Because we're busy. What are you busy doing? When you get to heaven, there's no need for sleep. There's a phrase, we don't need no stinking sleep. There's no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it. And there shall in no wise enter into anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. They're the only ones that make it in there. And when it comes to the Lamb's book of life, let me tell you something. We have to be focused on heaven to be able to make it. Or I doubt that you're going to make it. You got to be focused. The Lamb's Book of Life, you could go all the way back to Exodus 32, 32, and 33, and it talks about Moses trying to be that intercessor. And Moses is all tied up and just trying to help you. You got to come on. And all of a sudden, he intercedes for you. And he goes, God, I'll tell you what, man. He said, take my name out of the book just to save him and to save these people over here because they're idiots, man. I've had him out here for 40 years. And for 40 years, all they do is whine and bellyache. And it's not about you. He says, please erase my name. And the Lord told him in Exodus 32 and 33. He says, ain't going to happen. He says, those that commit iniquity against me, I will blot out of my book. The only thing that keeps you from God is your iniquity, unforgiven sin. Would you bow your heads with me? Heaven is real. It's not a joke. I never got to touch my notes this morning. But heaven is real. And I want you to know that Jesus loves you so much, he don't want to leave you behind at all. But will he? Yep. But here's what I like to say. He actually never forsook you at all. You forsook him. If you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Tim, my problem is I don't see heaven in my everyday life. You know what? We've made a mistake here in America. We haven't told this generation about heaven. Everything in front of them looks like hell. We haven't showed them heaven. Why? Heaven needs to be written upon your face. When they see you, they need to see heaven. They need to see the joy of the Lord. They need to see that you're doing something for Jesus. If that is not you, I don't want to waste 2 seconds. I'm going to open up these altars, and I think the Lord is touching you on the shoulder. And if he is, I want you to come. And I just want you to kneel up here, and I would like to pray for you. If the Lord's convincing you at all that you need to prepare yourself for heaven, then you need to answer that call. And if that's you, I'm just going to give you a moment. Feel free to come. I don't want you to be embarrassed about anybody around you. I don't want you to worry. Some of you, I can tell you, you're not prepared. Some of you need a healing. See, part of the thing that it mentions right there in the passage that we just read is those sorcerers. Sorcerers is a word, along with all the liars and everything, we have the sorcerers, and that word is pharmakias, and that word means that somehow you're an enchanter with drugs, which you have altered the way in which you think. And if you've altered the way in which you think, how are you going to pay attention to what God is doing? You can't. And it said, if you interfere with what God is trying to say to you, you can't be saved. He wants his Holy Spirit to take rule over your life. I want it to be so real to you guys. No jokes anymore. This is serious. Do you or do you not want your family to make it with you? Do you or do you not want to enter into the kingdom of God? If that's you, then the altars are here. And if I could, I'd like some beautiful people that love the Lord to come and just get behind some of these people, if you would, just to let them know that they're loved. You don't have to be loud or do anything. I just want them to know that there's somebody here that loves them and cares for them. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I ask, Lord, right now for your perfect, perfect divine appointment. to people in the lives that came up here. Lord, for the ones that are dealing with depression right now, I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. For the ones, Lord God, that have to take a bunch of meds just to try to feel regular, Lord, I pray that you will heal their bodies and heal their minds, Lord God. May it be so miraculous that they can't blame it on anything else, but I have had a divine appointment with God. For the one, Lord God, that's thinking about the relationship that they have right now with somebody, I ask right now that you will make it righteous. That they would not make that move, Lord. That they would keep it righteous. For the one, Lord God, that their children are having a really tough time, I ask right now, Father, that you will bless her, Lord God, and allow her children to come to Jesus. And let her be the Proverbs 31 woman, Lord God, that will lead them. For the one, Lord God, that is the poor father, I pray, Lord God, that you will make him a great father. Lord, for the one that's still sitting in the seats, the one, Lord God, that feels like crying but doesn't want to cry, the one that feels the emotion but doesn't really want to display it, for the one that knows what's going on and doesn't really want to say it, I pray, Lord God, that you will hear him. And you'll let him know, Lord God, that you are right here. And you are so present in his life. And you have blessed him all the way to this point. Keep your hand upon him, Lord. And let him hear what the Spirit would say to the church and let him overcome. And for that woman, Lord God, who literally has disconnected with her husband, I pray, Lord God, that you will give her, Lord God, back her love for her husband. Renew her heart, O God. Give her a passion again, Lord. And I pray that her husband, Lord God, will go home and find a different lady there. But do not let her passion run away from her husband. And now, Lord God, we thank you and praise you for the wonderful service, Lord God, that we've had today. We pray, Lord God, that all of these people that are being prayed for, that they would not go anywhere, Lord God, until they pray through. We pray, Lord God, for salvation upon all of them. Lord, some of them come here, Lord God, and they have really been through it. No more. You've called them when they were young. Now you're calling them again because you never left them. But they left you for a while. Grab a hold of them, Lord God, and bring them back. And today, Lord God, we claim this day with these people a victory. A victory. We are no longer victims of this world, but we are victorious through Jesus Christ. So thank you for it. And we give you glory and honor. Let them remain, Lord God, until they pray through. Let this congregation honor that. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen.